Hello, all my comedy friends. Nice to be back with you. And I hope that you are listening. I haven't heard from everybody in the class yet. I would like to. I think about half of you so far I've heard from. Not that there's anything due per se, but I would just like to know that you're well. That's all. Yeah, so there's two things that we're going to talk about today. This is going to be the last lecture on Menander. Thank God. Not the world's biggest Menander fan. And then we're going to talk a little bit about your paper topics at the end of this. So we'll do two things. So the first thing is Girl from Samos. Probably produced sometime around 310. But again, you know, it's, ancient dates are ancient dates. I don't have much more to say about Menander biographically. I think I've already covered that. So let's get right into the play so that we don't have to spend too much time on it. After all, this is just another of Menander's Who's the Baby's Daddy dramas. So we have the same setup on stage that we had in the Discolos, except this time it's a shrine of Apollo in the middle. And then on on either side is Demias and the Keratos. Oops. You're not a room. So Demias and the Keratos live on either side of the Shrine of Apollo. Demias' son is Moschion, his adopted son. So there's all kinds of, like, you know, legality issues and adoption issues. And the Keratos' daughter is Plangon. Anyway, Nikeratos is richer than Demias is, and Nikeratos has a girlfriend. Funny how the wife never makes an appearance in the play, but anyway, his girlfriend is called Chryses, not to be confused with Crisis. Not the same etymological root, but Chryses, which is it harkens back to the Iliad and first book of the Iliad. Chryses was the name of the girl that what's-his-face took, Achilles, and dragged off into slavery. So I don't want to go through plot by plot point here. It's not the world's most complicated thing. It is the same sort of thing that you might see on a sitcom when you turn on your TV today. What happens? Moschion knocks up Plangon. Demias knocked up Chryses, but Chryses' baby died. So to cover the extramarital relationship between for Moschion and Plangon, they give the baby to Chryses. Chryses nurses the baby. Nikeratos comes in and sees her nursing the baby and thinks, "What the hell's going on here? I never gave her a baby." And then he overhears the nurse. Of course, there's always going to be servants from now on. So this is another thing to get used to in comedy. In this case, his name is Parmenon. Just like Davos, Parmenon is going to be another name that comes up as a typical slave's name again and again in comedy. So what happens? Oh, I overheard. Oh, When has that ever been the plot of a sitcom? Never. It's never. No one's ever done that. Oh, misunderstanding and overhearing. So Nikarito sees Crisis nursing the baby that in fact actually belongs to Moscion and Plagon. So he gets all kinds of pissed off because he thinks that that means that Moscion, because when he overhears the nurse talking to herself, basically in the kitchen, assumes that, oh, well, she knows who the dad is, but she never mentions the mother. So there's this room for misinterpretation. Anyway, Nikaratos thinks Moscion's the dad. Now I'm confused about the plot. Anyway, there's this confusion over who the real dad is. They get in an Demias and Nikaratos get into an argument over it. Most the gist of the argument is about money. Who pays what for the wedding? Who pays what for the baby? And then at the end of it, Moscion, because he's pissed off at his dad, because he doesn't think his dad took his side well enough, he threatens to go off to Bactria. Now, here's something I don't know off the top of my head, so I'm going to look this up real quick just because I don't want to give you false information. So let me look this up real quick. It's definitely inland. It's definitely in Asia Minor. Okay, so Afghanistan, Tajikistan, Uzbekistan. Okay, so you have to remember that at this point, basically, the Romans have taken over. And basically, the best way for a young man to make his living is to join the military or the larger military apparatus that surrounds Roman expansion. It didn't necessarily mean having to go to fight. It could take other forms as well. They needed a lot of lawyers. They needed a lot of legislators. They needed a lot of secretaries. So it was what the nowadays, I say nowadays, this is an old fashioned term, but it's the civil service. It's what the British refer to as the civil service. Which is that you're working for the government. It doesn't necessarily mean that you're having to go and fight, but it does mean that you're doing government work. You're processing paperwork. You're doing taxes. You're reading applications. You're doing that kind of thing. But in any case, shit, now Carius, I bet is his name. Is that his name? Moscion, sorry. I get so confused with all the stock names in new comedy. Moscion goes off or threatens to go off to Bactria, which means that he's going to the end of the world to be a mercenary because his dad refuses to acknowledge the legitimacy of his son and all that stuff. Anyway, it all ends in a happy ending, right? It all ends up in a big wedding, which... It should not be a surprise to you in any way, shape, or form. So Moscion says he's going off the best part of partner on the slave. Demias, everything ends with a big wedding. So it's a big happy ending. And that's the last we will do of Greek comedy. From the anti-heroism of Homer, through what we might identify as something like nihilism. I don't want to call it that exactly because that's a later coinage and it would be anachronistic to say that, but something like nihilism in Archilochos, through the comic reversal motif in the Fables of Aesop, the parody of the Mice and Frogs, through to the sex and poop romps and comic violence romps of Aristophanes, now down to Menander, where everything becomes middle class again, right? So the play is set in Athens, but doesn't have to be set in Athens. Like, you could take this play and produce it in Syracuse, in Sicily, and you could just change the setting to Syracuse. No one would know the difference. It doesn't make any difference, right? But you couldn't have done that with the clouds, because the clouds is filled with jokes that only Athenians would get, right? But now we're at the stage of comedy where it has to play across the board. And so I know I've been hard on Menander, people loved him. He was extremely popular. But so is James Cameron. Being popular and having something to say aren't necessarily exchangeable commodities. So what else do I have to say today to you? I promise you this is going to be a short lecture, and I meant it. It's going to be under 20 minutes, because in the next lecture, we start Roman comedy. Don't make me talk about Roman comedy yet. I'll get there. So there is another theme that I want to bring up, because it's going to be relevant to your paper prompts. I sent you my April Fool's joke about having to write a 20-page paper and all that stuff, and the stuff about the length and the formatting and all that. That was just a joke. I was just riffing. But the actual topic of that paper, I was serious about. I want you to be thinking about the theme of Gnosos. Pretty sure we already talked about this when we talked about the Odyssey. But what Gnostos means is homecoming, to return home, right? We combine this with another Greek word, algos. Which means pain. And we get the English word nostalgia, which means the suffering, the pain you feel when you're not at home. I know that we usually, this word in English is used to mean reminiscence of times gone past. Oh, don't tempt me. What am I nostalgic for? I'm nostalgic for a lot of things. I'm a nostalgic kind of guy. So I can't deny that. But what nostalgia means is the pain that you feel when you're not at home. Okay. Which most of us are, this is like, you know, not most of us probably want to get out of our houses right now. So we feel the opposite of nostalgia. But it'll come back to you at some point. And yeah, okay. So let me get back to this idea of nostos. This is a thing about comedy in the sense that, like, it's this return to home motif that carries on across comedy. We can look at it from the earliest stages. We can look at it from the Odyssey. Of course, the moral of the story in the Odyssey is that Odysseus returns to home. We can look at it from the archly ironic position of Aristophanes in the Clouds, where Pheidippides' return to home means an overturning of the home. And then we get into, I'm sorry, I'm going to stop talking now because you're going to have to write your paper on this, and I don't want to read 15 of the same papers. So your paper topic is going to be on the topic of nostos. It's going to be on the topic of homecoming, right? And you can include in this other things that we've talked about over the semester, the oikeia heidone, all of those things. Certainly, I want you to include new comedy, Menander, and his emphasis on the role of going back to home. I mean, you think back to the Discolos, it's Cnemon, Gorgias' Cnemon's half-son, but there's a reunion of families that happens at the end of it. Of course, the arbitration at the end of it, the baby's real parents are recognized and he's a legitimate citizen, so everything is okay. Who's the baby's dad and who's the baby's mom? That's not gonna go away. That's gonna be a motif in comedy. For a long time, and by for a long time, I mean like, you know, up till like yesterday. These are the templates that are set out, and I don't want to talk any more about this because, like I said, I don't want to read 50 of the same page papers. So your basic talk, so let me lay out the parameters for you on your papers. Put it this way. What I am expecting is a paper of between 1,000 and 1,500 words. So that means between five and a half, six pages of double-spaced, Times New Roman. It's not hard to change your font. I don't want to read your paper in Comic Sans Serif, or the comedy, whatever, if you, or Wingbats, Dingbats, I forget. It's called whatever. You please send it in a doc format because that's the easiest way for me to open it. And then I will read your papers and I will send you comments back on your papers. There isn't a due date as such because it doesn't seem fair to me to set a due date as such. I will say this, though, the sooner you write your paper, the sooner I can read it, the more attention I can pay to it. If you leave it all the way to the end of the semester, which ends on, what, March 31st? I don't know, my syllabus is in front of me. Oh, shit. Let me go get it. Enjoy the background for a moment. Doopy doo, doopy doopy doo. It's gotta be here somewhere. Oh well. I can't find it now. I can't put my hands on it right now. At some point in May, like mid-May, May 14th or something like that. But don't wait that long. Please don't wait that long. Because I would really like to pay attention to what you all have to write. I certainly appreciate all of the emails that some of you have sent me, and I appreciate some of the comments on the YouTube channel. I would like to hear from all of you because I would like to be sure that you are all well, apart from anything else. And next time we're going to talk about Plautus, our first Roman author. So that's going to be a longer lecture than this one is. So this one is short. I don't really have that much more to say about Menander. He's basically sitcom, and you know, like I said before, baby daddy drama. And all right, now you pissed me off. This is at a more, because comedy deals with serious issues, right? So it's easy to take comedy lightly because jokes are funny, ha ha ha, and then you forget about it. But in reality, the whole mechanism of comedy is to also address issues that are current in society. And comedy can do that in a way that tragedy isn't necessarily equipped to do that. Right? Tragedy is equipped to deal with big ideas, you know, justice and the existence of God. You know, these huge, massive ideas. Whereas comedy is more equipped to deal with the way that things happen on a day-to-day basis. So that's why the best comedy is very topical, right? If I could send you clips to old Saturday Night Live pieces from the 70s and 80s that I still think are freaking hilarious, but you wouldn't even like remotely get the joke because you wouldn't even know who they're talking about in those clips, right? Because talk comedy is here and now, right? And it's supposed to be here and now. So that's what Aristophanes is. You know, that's what Archilochos is. Like, it's here and now. And then you get into this other, and then you move over into the, so as we work down the course of stage comedy, as you move from old comedy through middle comedy into new comedy, what you begin to see is that, hey, what's funny now? I don't know. I can't make fun of anybody specifically. So let's just make jokes that everybody, the guy falls down a hole, who doesn't find that funny anywhere? You know, dudes, adopted son knocks up the next door neighbor's daughter. Well, right. And then he overhears a conversation and it's like, you know, oh, he's, you know, he said, she said. And then at the end, of course, at the end, Moskian comes on stage. Like I mentioned this already. But he says, I'm going off to be a mercenary in Bactria because he knows that's going to scare the shit out of his dad. It's all very It's all very middle classness with Menander. I don't. That's my interpretation. It's not. I'm sure that's not universally shared across all scholars. I was talking about your papers, and now I'm back to talking about Menander. So yeah, due dates on your paper. Do them now. Just do them now, and send them to me. On the jpletcher@brooklyn.cuny.edu email, same ones, top of your syllabus, and do them as soon as possible, because the quicker I get them, the quicker I can read them, and the more time that I can spend on them, and I have no sense of time anymore. I'm sure you all are going through the same experience where, like, you know, 8 hours goes by in the time span of what takes 1 hour, and yet at the same time, 1 hour goes by in what takes time in the space of 8 hours. That's just where we're living with right now. Okay, I'm gonna play you out. Thank you.
Okay.
So for those of you all who have watched to the end of the video, I have one more thing that I thought of that I probably should have said during the lecture, which is that when Moskian threatens to go to Bactria, what he's actually threatening is to disrupt the balance of the home, and that of course is not acceptable under the rules of comedy, because as we know, comedy is all about restoration of the home and rejuvenation. Okay, so that's that. See you tomorrow. Bye.